Good morning. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We will now start our order of service. I will be reading announcements. Discipleship Bible Study every Tuesday at 11 a.m., Thursday at 7 p.m. on Zoom. Information on our Facebook page. BOL Prayer Line Ministry Hours every Wednesday, 6:30 a.m. until 7 a.m. The phone number, 720-843-2194. Access code 668-999, PAL. Leadership meeting next Sunday following the morning service. Our food ministry, Eat to Live. We are offering fresh fruit and vegetables right from the Maryland farm starting June the 7th until November, every other Friday. We will start serving at 9 a.m. until we are complete. We will be right on the campus serving these delicious items. The trustee for the month is Brother Stanley Scurry. Please notify him if you need access to the church. You can reach him at 410-446-0336. Thank you. The Angels of Faith Children Choir. Rehearsal every first and third Sunday at the church. All children are welcome to share and develop the gifts that the Lord has given. Reverend Denise Norfleet Walker, former Cherry Hill United Methodist member and lay servant, will be honored for her years of service at a retirement celebration on Saturday, June the 8th, from 1 p.m. until 5 p.m. at the Forum, 4210 Pembroke Avenue, Baltimore, Maryland, 21215. Tickets are $100. The media ministry will be having a lip-sync cowboy concert set July 20th, 2024. Tickets donations will be $10. Put on your cowboy get up and mosey on to our lip-sync concert and round up some of your neighbors, family, and friends. Come on out for a time of fun, food, and fellowship. Father's Day celebration. Come celebrate Father's Day with breakfast here at the church on June 16th from 8 a.m. until 10 a.m. All fathers, brothers, uncles, nephews, and families are welcome. Thank you, the United Women in Faith. Save the date, June 23rd. Two service for the usher's 79th anniversary. Dinner will be served. Our prayer list. Carrie Cephas, Helen Coates, Leroy Henry are all at home. Sister Ann Quarles is at the long-term living rehab. And now our pastor's moment.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, y'all, let's give God some praise in his house because we know that the Lord is good. He is worthy to be praised from the rising of the sun until the going down of the same. We give God praise. Glory, glory to God. We just want to continue to lift up those names that was lifted up for the power of prayer. Amen. We ask that you continue to keep those sick in recovery lifted up in your prayers because we know the power of prayer and what prayer can do and will do. Amen. We lift the name of Jesus up. On next Sunday, we're looking for a powerful, powerful time in the Lord as we celebrate Father's Day. Amen. For the men and men of the church. Amen. We just want to just ask that you. Amen. June 16th. Amen. Mark that on your calendar as the Lord continues to bless us in a powerful way. We ask that you keep our men lifted up in your prayers. Amen. So come on out and celebrate us with on Men's Day. Glory to God. Also, we just want to ask that you will continue to, if you're not a part of any Bible study, be a part of what the Lord is doing in our Bible study twice a week on Tuesdays and Thursdays. All the time and information to get on the Bible study is listed for you, as well as our prayer line ministry. Amen. How many know the power of prayer? What prayer can do? Amen. We are on our prayer line at 6:30 every Wednesday. We invite you, if you're not a part of a prayer line ministry, we invite you to be a part of what the Lord is doing here. We are touching folk all over the country, amen, on our prayer line, praying for folk that's standing in need of prayer. So continue to keep our prayer line lifted up in the name of Jesus. Also, we want to want you to be mindful of our food ministry, amen, here at Cherry Hill. We are blessing folk all, not only in the Cherry Hill community, but we are blessing folk from that's coming from all parts of the city, amen, being a part of our prayer, I mean, being a part of our food ministry, amen. So we want to keep that in mind going through this summer season, amen, and we'll be serving fresh fruit, vegetables, amen, every other Tuesday, starting on this coming, every other Friday, starting on this coming Friday. Our food ministry will serve vegetables and fruit, amen. So we invite you to come on out and get some of that fruit and vegetables. Eat to live, amen. Just continue to lift us up, those that are on social media with us. Continue to pray for us as we continue to pray for you, as we continue to do the will of God, what our assignment is, amen. To God be the glory for the great and wonderful and powerful things that he is doing in the life of this church, amen, and in the life of those who are diligently seeking the face of God, amen, amen. Now, wherever you may be right now at this moment in time, whether you're tuning in with us or whether you're here live with us, we're going to ready our hearts for a word of prayer this morning, amen, as we offer praises and prayer unto you, amen. Amen. I want to ask as Sister Sharon comes to lift us up in prayer, we just want to ask if you're able to just reach out and touch someone that may be beside you this morning, if you're home, wherever you may be at in your home, even right now, we just want to ask that you would just grab somebody by the hand, just touch somebody this morning, because we know the power of touch. We know the power of a touch this morning. Somebody somewhere have not been touched, has not been held, has not been hugged all week long. And we just want to remind you that when you come in contact with the Savior, and his name is Jesus, the touch will never be the same again. Amen. Glory to God.
Touch our hearts, Lord God. Lord, continue to strengthen us, Lord God. Because you said you would never leave no one nor forsake them. You know all about the ones in jails, Lord God. Father God, you already know about them, Lord God. So we just lift them up right now, Lord God. We just lift everybody up, Lord God. We just ask that you just give everybody a touch, Lord God, to go on and run this race a little while longer, Lord God. Father God, I want to just end, Lord God, the way you told us to pray, Lord God, by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day, Lord God, our daily bread. Forgive us, Lord Jesus, those who trespass against us, Lord God, and those who trespass against us, Lord Jesus. Lead us not to temptation, Lord God, but deliver us from evil, Lord God. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever, Lord God. Our soul says amen. Amen, Lord God.
Amen. Can we get Sister Sharon another hand for that beautiful prayer? Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Thank you.
will now have our tithes and offerings.
Really? You sure?
Oh, I'm sorry. We will now have the Old Testament reading by Sister Yvette Wilson and the New Testament reading by Sister Thelma McBride.
Verses 1 through 6, drop down to 13 through 18. A Psalm of David. God investigated my life. Get all the facts firsthand. I am an open book to you. Even from a distance, you know what I am thinking. You know when I leave and when I get back. I'm never out of your sight. You know everything I'm going to say before I start the first sentence. I look behind me and you're there. Then look ahead and you're there too. Your reassuring presence coming and going. This is too much, too wonderful. I can't take it all in. Drop down to 13. Oh yes, you shake me first inside, then out. You formed me in my mother's womb. I thank you, high God. You're breathtaking, body and soul. I am marvelously made. I worship in adoration. What a creation. You know me inside and out. You know every bone in my body. You know exactly how I was made, bit by bit. How I was sculptured from nothing into something. Like an open book. You watch me grow from conception to birth. All the stages of my life were spread out before you. The days of my life are prepared before I even live one. Your thoughts, how rare, how beautiful. God, I've never comprehended them. I cannot, could not even begin to count them any more than I could count the grains of sand of the sea. The word of the Lord. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm going to be reading the New Testament, 2 Timothy, chapter 1, from 1 through 6. Those who are able to stand, please do. Have a say, amen.
Amen.
Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, according to the promise of life which is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my dearly beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God whom I serve from my forefathers with pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers, night and day. Greatly desiring to see thee, become mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. Wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. Yeah. Thanks be to thee, O Christ.
Amen. y'all. Come on now. I mean, God got us through this week. We in the house of the Lord. It may not be full in here, but God want to hear our blessings. God want to hear us give him praise for what he's done for us. He'll deal with the ones that's not here. So I need y'all to wake up and praise God. We will now have tithes and offerings. And I want to see all teeth, smiles coming down that aisle. That is able to stand, can we please stand and follow the directions of the usher? Thank you. We will have another selection.
Thank you.
we give God praise. Come on, give God some praise. Let's give God praise in the house. Being that, I encourage y'all to go and read that about Jabez. Jabez's prayer. Glory to God. Jabez prayed that the Lord will enlarge his territory. And I don't know about you, somebody has been praying that the Lord would enlarge their territory. I'm talking to somebody today. Glory. But there's a word today that will just tie right into enlarging your territory. And then to enlarge your territory, you got to be honest. You have to be unashamed of the gospel. Glory to God. If you're ashamed of the gospel, you're not going to be able to enlarge the territory. And there's a word for somebody today, amen, that's been praying about enlarging their territory. Glory to God. I greet you, my brothers and my sisters, in the name of Jesus the Christ. There is no other name given under the heavens by which man can be saved. We serve a true and living God. We serve a kind of God that every time that we look up, every time that he looks down upon us, he comes to see about his child. He comes to see about us just when we stand in need of a breakthrough. Is there anybody here this morning standing in need of a breakthrough? All I need is about two or three of us standing in need of a breakthrough. Glory to God. Has been praying and has been on their knees about a breakthrough. Glory to God. But we got to be unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ if we want a breakthrough. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. There's a word, if you would be so kind to look at 2 Timothy. We want to preach from a word from 2 Timothy this morning. 2 Timothy, the first chapter. And I want to read these verses here in your hearing. 2 Timothy, the first chapter. I want to read verses 1 through 6. 1 through 6 in your hearing. And I'll be reading this from the New International Version in your hearing. Beginning in verse 1. Paul, the apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, according to the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank you. Listen to Paul here. Paul says, I thank God, whom I serve, as my forefathers did with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Verse 4, recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I've been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lewis and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Verse 6, for this reason I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you, through the laying on the hands. Amen. I want to put a paper clip right there in your hearing. And I want to preach as the Spirit shall guide for the time that we will share together from the thought, unashamed of the gospel. Unashamed of the gospel. My brothers and my sisters, as we will be engaged for these few weeks in this season of Pentecost, we want to look at the power of the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit operates in the lives of believers, how the Holy Spirit moves and has its way in the life of believers, how the Holy Spirit gives us power in the midst of whatever we're going through. And that is what God has given us through the power of the Holy Spirit. Oh, my brothers and my sisters here, as we go down the runway of this text here in 2 Timothy, first chapter, we find the Apostle Paul. We find him writing, we find him operating in his anointing. And he is not only operating in his anointing, but Paul is explaining to young Timothy the good news of the gospel. Somebody say the good news of the gospel. Reminding him here that eternal life is available to all. Not to some, but to all who receive it through faith. So he wants him to know that in order for us to receive it, we have to receive it through what? Faith. He was reminding Timothy of his calling, and he was reminding Timothy of his relationship with him, because see, Paul had a great relationship with Timothy. He poured into Timothy. Timothy, in other words, was his student. He poured into young Timothy. He wanted to strengthen Timothy. He reminded him and he affirmed him of his own apostolic calling by the will of God. And he explains this to him in verses 1 and 2 of the text. Here we find Paul, he's expressing his gratitude to God. Paul is lifting up and he's expressing his gratitude to God and whom he served with a clear conscience. His ancestors here, Paul is talking about here in verse 3 and 4 here. Can I just set the context of this text here? And then we're going to move along. But I want to give you a clear understanding of what is taking place here in this letter. See, Paul is reminding Timothy of the sincere faith that he has, a faith that lived not only in Timothy's grandmother, Lois, but it also lived in his mother, Eunice, if you will. So what we have here, my brothers and my sisters, we see the power begins to flow down from Jesus Christ into his grandmother, and then it flows down from his grandmother into his mother, and then it pours into Timothy here. See, Paul mentions this to highlight generational faith, if you will. Faith that was passed down to Timothy. And somebody here this morning has some faith passed down to them. Am I right about it this morning? Somebody had a praying grandmother that prayed for your mother. Somebody had a praying grandmother that prayed for your father. Somebody had, so it was passed down.
Yeah.
And Paul just wanted to make sure that Timothy understood this generational faith that was now dwelling in Timothy. And Paul wanted to remind Timothy, and not only remind Timothy here, my brothers and my sisters, but he wanted to encourage Timothy. And every now and again, I know David says sometimes we got to encourage ourselves, but here, Timothy was getting encouraged by Paul. Timothy was encouraged about his family heritage. And there was a flame, see, there was a flame that was burning deep down inside of Timothy. And the Bible does not tell us whether Timothy fully understood this fire, this flame that was burning down inside of him. But he had the teacher Paul to explain these things to him. Paul wanted to remind Timothy about how to utilize this spiritual gift, how to use this gift, and not only how he was going to receive it, but how he was going to pour into the people, how he was going to pour into the ministry, how he was going to pour this faith into others as he ministers the gospel. Because, see, the Bible reminds us that throughout the New Testament, that spiritual gift has been given out to individuals. And I'm so glad to be reminded that, when this spiritual gift that has been given out, it's been given out to you. It's been given into you, and it was given out to you so that you can receive it, so that you will not lack faith, so that you can understand this power. They were not able to receive the fullness of that gift. See, some folk have
this gift, but they don't fully understand how this faith is operating, how this spirit is operating in them. But I'm reminded in the Gospel of Luke, in Luke 18, if you will, the Bible talks about this young rich ruler. Yeah, who asked the question, what good he could do to inherit the kingdom of life? And because of the lack of faith that this young ruler had, because of the lack of spiritual discernment that he had, he was not able to receive the fullness of God. You remember the story. He left, he went away, and the Bible says that he went away with tears. Why? Because he did not understand the fullness of what God had given him. Then we go over and we look in the Gospel of Mark. Mark the 9th chapter, if you will. Verses 30 and 32, if you can reflect on that. You remember when Jesus was teaching the disciples and Jesus said the Son of Man. He was explaining to them that the Son of Man would be betrayed. And he would be betrayed in the hands of men. Oh, they would kill him. And then Jesus was explaining to him after 3 days, you know, he would rise up again. But the Bible said that they didn't understand. They couldn't quite grasp it, Sister Diane. They couldn't quite receive it. They did not understand it. And because of their lack of faith, they couldn't receive the fullness of that gift at that given time. And again, we find it over in Mark, the 10th chapter. Oh, I'm setting the content here. I'm giving you some content for this passage of scripture. Over in Mark 10, verses 35 and 45 through 45. Bible says that James and John, they lack faith. They lack faith, and not only faith, but they lack some spiritual discernment. Oh, when they asked Jesus, you remember those boys. Those boys came to Jesus, and they said, Jesus, let one of us sit at your right hand, and the other at your left hand in glory. And my beloved, Jesus was saying to the believers, and he's saying to the unbelievers today, that if there is a lack of faith, it's going to keep you. If there's any lack of faith, it's going to keep you from receiving the fullness in God. It is the lack of faith that is keeping us ashamed of the gospel. Let me say that again. It's the lack of faith, Brother Curtis, that is keeping us ashamed of the gospel instead of unashamed of the gospel. And I don't know why Paul picks it up here in Timothy, the 1st chapter here, to remind us that every believer is promised. Somebody say promised. Every believer is promised a gift, a spiritual gift by God, and the power of the Holy Spirit. So we're not only getting the gift, but God is giving us power to operate in the gift. See, it's important, my brothers and my sisters, that we know that we have a gift, but God wants to get us with the Holy Spirit. Because see, when the Holy Spirit connects with the gift, that's when we receive, can I teach this thing? That's when we receive the power. Is there anybody here looking for some power today? Something in verse 6, the Bible says, for this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying hands, through the laying on of my hands. See, Paul wanted them to understand that you have the gift. The gift is there, but every now and again, when the Holy Spirit connects with the gift, sometimes you gotta fan it. Sometimes you got to encourage it. Sometimes you got to understand. Or it will lay dormant if you let it lay dormant. He wants us to understand that every now and again, what the Holy Spirit will do to the gift, it'll fan it. It'll get the flames going. It'll get power going. Or in other words, my beloved, oftentimes this gift is not given to us in full development. That means that the gift that you've given, it may not even have fully developed yet.
That means that he's giving you a gift to sing,
if you will.
But he has not fully developed that gift.
Well, in order for you to get it fully developed, you have to use that gift.
In other words, if the gift is given to us by the Holy Spirit, we have to use it. We have to nurture it. We have to develop it. We have to utilize it. And most of all, we have to operate it. And somebody's out there, somebody's sitting out here today that has a gift that you're not operating in. You have a gift that God has blessed you with, and you let it lay there. It's sitting there. God wants you, because he wants you to understand that that Holy Spirit that dwells and moves inside of you, what it will do to the gift that he's giving you, it will fan. It will fan the gift. And that gift will begin to grow. That gift will begin to develop. That gift will be able to take you to some places that you ain't never been before. Is anybody here? Oh, we have to fan it. We have to fan into the flame the gift of God, which is in you. In other words, my beloved, Paul was God's instrument. He was God's instrument through whom the gift flowed from Paul to Timothy. Can you see this picture here? That gift begins to flow from Paul, and it flowed to Timothy. And just like Paul in the text that was read in your hearing this morning, he begins to pour into Timothy. He wanted to wake that gift up. He wanted to wake that spirit up. He wanted to shake that gift up that was in him. This gift, my beloved, was the Holy Spirit. That gift was the Paraclete. That gift was the Holy Spirit. Is there anybody here this morning that knows that this spirit that Paul is talking about will wake you up? It will shake you up. It will move you. It will take you to some places. This gift inside of you wants to take you to some places. And if the truth be told, it is evident that Paul understood that when it wasn't enough to receive the gift, but the gift must be awakened. Paul knew it had to be awakened. This gift must be activated here. While looking at the text, it is also here. It is also evident here that Timothy was responsible. Somebody say responsible. He was responsible for keeping the gift alive. It was his responsibility to keep this gift active. It wasn't Paul's responsibility. Paul planted the seed, but God says that if he'll plant the seed, then he'll send somebody along the way to water that seed. If I'm talking to somebody today, God wants to bless you. God wants to keep you. God wants to deliver you. And every now and again, if we move too slow, if we're not doing the things that God has assigned us to do, God sometime, he'll bring somebody in your space. They'll speak a word of life, not death. God loves you so much. He wants you to use that spiritual gift that he gave you, because the Holy Spirit here, it's the supernatural power of God. Yeah, filling out human vessels like you and I. It wants to establish, it wants to advance the kingdom of God on earth. So this Holy Spirit specifically has an assignment, and that assignment is to help us move in the kingdom of God. It's to help us develop God's kingdom right here on earth. Oh, my brothers and my sisters, not only it's a supernatural power of God, but this Holy Spirit, it's a supernatural equipment. It's the equipment, and this equipment will fulfill the great commission to continue the ministry of Jesus. In other words, you are the vessel that will extend the ministry of God right here on earth. But we have to keep this spirit us by the gospel. We can't be ashamed. We can't be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We can't be ashamed. We have to be unashamed of this gospel. This gospel wants us to take this gospel out into the kingdom of God and tell somebody that there is a true and living God. That gospel wants to go out beyond these four walls and tell somebody that there's a God we live and a God we will serve. That gospel, all that gospel, want us to be unashamed of the gospel. We got to tell it sometime. Sometime this gospel don't want us to hold it in. We got to tell somebody about the goodness of God.
Destroy the works of the devil.
And then he picked it up over in Hebrews, the 13th chapter, verse 8. It reminds us that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. See, Jesus' ministry had never changed. And that's what I like about Jesus. It never changed. We might change. But his word never changes. Yeah, we are commissioned, church. We are commissioned and anointed to continue this ministry right here where we are, right here on earth. If there's one thing that we need in our churches today, if there's one thing that we need in our churches today and in our lives as individuals today, we need a fresh anointing. We need a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit. We don't need a stale anointing. We need a fresh anointing. Because when we get that fresh anointing, we need an invasion. We need an invasion of the Holy Spirit to fall down on us. To come down on us. To fall down, to invade our state. To invade our household of faith. Now, we need an invasion of the Spirit. Something that will shake us up. Shook up. Something that will shake us. Something that will wake us. Something that will set us on fire for the Lord. Oh, the Holy Spirit might just fall on us. Might fall on us right in the midst of whatever our condition is. Whatever our circumstances is. The Holy Spirit will show up and can fall on us right there in the midst of it. And when he falls on us, it will be like fire. Jeremiah said it will be like fire. Shut up in our bones. Oh, see, Paul reminded us here. Go to Romans, the first chapter, verse 16. Romans 1:16. The Bible says these words. It says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel."
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because it is the power of God that brought salvation to everyone who believes. First to the Jews. And then to the Gentiles. So he's reminding us, he's saying, Paul is saying to us, not to be ashamed of the gospel. And somebody needs to understand the word of God. See, the word of God can stir us up. It can stir us up. It can fan the flames of the Holy Spirit in us. And when it does that, it'll make us unashamed of the gospel. Why? Because when that fire gets a hold of us, when that power gets a hold of us, oh, we can't hold it. Something began to work. We can't keep it to ourselves. We might try to hold it, keep it to ourselves, but when that fire gets a hold of us, oh, when it gets a hold of us, somebody needs to understand this. If we want to be unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, it is essential for salvation. Somebody say it's essential for salvation to be unashamed of the gospel. It is essential for salvation. Why? Because John 3:16 tells us, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his what? His only begotten Son. So whoever believes in him what shall not perish, but have everlasting life." It's that salvation that he gives. Oh, that's why we can't be, that's why we got to be unashamed of this gospel. We got to tell it when folk don't want to hear it. We got to say it when they don't believe it. We got to preach it when it needs to be preached. We got to sing it and mean it. We got to trust the gospel if we're going to be unashamed of the gospel. We got to keep the gospel. If we're going to be unashamed for the gospel. And we got to guard the gospel. We got to guard the gospel. Because the gospel can give us power. Oh, when we receive the power of the gospel inside, it will make you unashamed, Brother Curtis. This gospel will make you unashamed on the outside. As I ponder this message this morning, as I ponder this message, Paul's word to Timothy this morning. Paul's word, should have been speaking to us these words. If there's one thing that we're missing in our churches, in our personal lives, is that we need, it's the energy. Somebody say energy. We need the energy. the anointing of the Holy Spirit. That Holy Spirit will not only break yoke, but it will destroy yoke. The power of the Holy Spirit. The Bible reminds us that on the day of Pentecost, when the mighty power of the Holy Spirit, you know the story, everybody got a flame. Everybody got a flame. It was their personal Pentecost. Every person was responsible to fan their own flame of Pentecost, to keep the fire burning, to keep it burning. In other words, we must activate the gift in us. And the question is, church, how do we activate the flame and the gift of the Holy Spirit? How do we do it? We have to prepare our hearts and we got to prepare our minds to get it. We have to receive that power, and the Lord has for each and every one of us as believers. He got a purpose and a plan for us. In other words, we have to prepare and then be unashamed and be unashamed of the gospel. What does that mean? It means that we have to get rid of some stuff in our lives. That means that we got to get rid of some junk that are holding us down. We have to get rid of some situations and some circumstances in our lives. We have to get rid of some people in our lives. And then after we do that, then we have to repent. Somebody say repent. Then we have to repent. That means seeking the Lord while he can still be found. We have to repent. That means that we have to pray. If we're going to be unashamed of the gospel, we got to pray. That means that we have to spend some time worshiping and before the Lord in prayer and in worship. That means that we have to read God's word. If we're going to be unashamed of the gospel, we have to study God's word. And if we're going to be unashamed of the gospel, and I don't know about you, church, before I sit down and get out of your way, we have to prepare. I prepare the clothes. Paul reminds us that we have to fan the flame of the gift of God. We have to activate that gift of God. There is an anointing on somebody in this house. There is an anointing upon your life. There's an anointing upon you. Don't you know that you have power? Don't you know that God has blessed you? Don't you know that God has kept you? There's an anointing. There's a fire that's inside of you. There's a fire that's waiting to be released. All you have to do is fan the flame. Oh, somebody needs to know that this house this morning, we got to keep the fire burning. We got to keep it burning if we want to be unashamed of the gospel of Christ. We can't afford to let the fire go out. Somebody just tell somebody beside you, I can't afford to let the flame go out. I can't afford for it to go out. Somebody needs to know we can't afford it. When the fire is activated in our lives, you are unashamed of the gospel. You can activate others. Don't you know when the flame and the fire is activating in on you, don't you know that you can activate somebody else? You can activate it. See, because just like Paul, he activated Timothy in the text. And when you're on fire, you can release some fire to somebody else. Or when you got fire in you, when you got the power in you, don't you know that you can give off some heat? Don't you know that you can give off some heat, church? Paul released it to Timothy here in the text. And when you are unashamed of the gospel and the fire for the Lord, you'll know beyond the shadow of a doubt. You'll know when you have fire. You'll know when the Holy Spirit is moving. You'll know it. You'll know it because God will remind you, because the word of God says that the Lord did not give you a spirit of fear. He's giving you a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. Is there somebody here today? Don't mind praising God. Don't mind thanking God. Don't mind lifting up the name of Jesus. You want to praise him. God is good. God's be unashamed. Because when you're unashamed, there's power. When you're unashamed, God will move. When you're unashamed of the gospel, God will speak life and not death. God will allow you to plant some seeds in somebody else's life. Why? Because he knows that you're unashamed. He knows that you'll tell it, and you'll tell it in season and out of season. He'll know that you won't rebuke somebody, but in the name of Jesus, he knows that you will deliver. He can count on you. Continue to be unashamed. Amen. All over this place, all over this room, the Spirit of the Lord is speaking even right now. The Lord is speaking right now. Somebody in this place. The doors of the church is open. It's open right now. Let us pray together with every head bowed, every eye closed. Every heart praying in this place. Unashamed of the gospel. Father God, as we gather right now, God, under the power and the anointing of your word this morning, God. There may be someone even in this house this morning, God, who may at one point in their life has been unashamed, but have fallen from a point of unashamed to ashamed. But God, we ask right now, God, with every head bowed, every eye closed in this place, there may be someone under the sound of my voice who has been ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. With every head bowed, I want to ask if you would just hold up your hand if there's ever been a point in your life where you have been ashamed of letting someone know that you serve a true and living God. There might have been someone in this house who's been on that job and knew how good the Lord has been to you, but you never said a mumbling word because you was ashamed that someone would look at you a different way. Come on, somebody. There might be someone in here in this place today who wants to move from that state of being ashamed to the state of being unashamed. The Lord is speaking to you right now in that small, still voice. There may be someone right now who's standing in need of prayer, whatever that prayer might be, whatever their circumstances might be. Somebody might need some strength to be unashamed of the gospel. Someone might need some help along the way to strengthen their faith. I want you to excuse yourself from wherever you are this morning and come to this altar because the Lord is speaking right now. He says, I want to touch that one. I want to give strength to that one this morning who's coming to this altar unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Come to this altar because we want to pray with you this morning. Because we're in all different walks of life. Your faith may not be like someone else's faith, and their faith might not be like yours. But the Bible tells us that we all have a measure of faith. And whatever your faith is right now, come to this altar because God has given an increase. And that's what we sang about this morning. Jabez was saying, I want an increase. There may be someone in this house right now is looking for an increase. Come on and excuse yourself. To all the person that's sitting beside you, say, excuse me, I need to get to the Lord this morning. Come on to this altar. in this house, I don't know who it is, just this week, they were asking for an increase. I don't know whether it was a financial increase that they were asking for. I don't know if it was some healing that they were standing in need of. You know, it doesn't matter to our God. Why? Because he'll look beyond our faults. And he'll meet us at our knees, and he wants to meet you right here at this altar. Because when you leave this place today, God wants to make you unashamed. God makes you want to stand flat-footed and say, for God I live and for God I die. And when you tell somebody this, they may not understand. But you serve a God who is able. The Bible says that he's able to do exceedingly and abundantly beyond all that we ask, think, or even imagine. What a God we serve. And as we gather here this day, as we gather here, when you leave this place today, when you walk out of these doors today, I want you to continue to pray that you be unashamed. Is that all right?
Yes.
Be unashamed. Stand flat-footed and say, I serve a God who is able. Stand flat-footed and remind the devil, look at the devil and say, devil, you can't steal my joy. Because you didn't give me this joy. The world gave me that kind of joy. But I serve someone who will make me unashamed of the gospel. So I'm saying to someone today, go unashamed and tell somebody about the goodness of the gospel, because that's what the gospel is. It's good news. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Father God, we thank the six, God, that are standing here at this altar, oh God. You know what each one of them, Lord, stands in need of. You know what each one that's in our pews today, God, stands in need of, God. So we ask right now, God, in your healing name, in that saving name, in that name which is above all names, God, we ask that you strengthen them, God, so that they can become unashamed of the word. God, we ask even right now, God, when they leave out of this place, God, we ask, oh God, that someone will come along the way and water what they heard today, to give them confirmation about some revelation that they heard today, God. We thank you. God, we thank you for those that are here with us today and those that are on our social media today, God. We thank you for them, oh God. We thank you for them, Lord, and remind them wherever they are, whatever season that they may be in their lives, God. We ask, oh God, that they will be unashamed of the gospel. That they'll go down the highways and the byways and the hedges and tell somebody about your goodness. Tell somebody about your grace and tell somebody about your mercy. God, we thank you today, oh God. We thank you for all that we've heard, all that we've seen, Lord. All that resonated in our spirits, oh God. And we give you praise. We give you glory. From the rising of the sun, God, and the going down of the same, we bless you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Glory to God. Go in peace. Unashamed of that gospel. Glory to God. Let us prepare today.
My mind belongs to you.
Amen. Glory to God. Let us prepare ourselves for those who have the sacraments. If you don't have the sacraments, would just be so kind to raise your hand, and one of the ushers will make sure that you receive one. Amen. Amen. The sacraments. Those are with us today, amen. We'll be looking at page 12 in the hymnal, those that have hymnals in the pews, amen. As we prepare our hearts to share in the supper that Jesus has shared with his disciples. Glory to God, page 12. Christ our Lord invites you to his table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another.
Merciful to God, we confess that we have failed you with our whole heart. We have failed to be obedient church. We have not done your will. You have broken your law. You have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of need. Forgive us, we pray. Free us, Lord, for obedience. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Lord of God, amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to our
It is right and a good and joyful thing always, everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 Lord, God, God, God.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. Deliver us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. For your Spirit, make us one with Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Why don't you come to your feet all over the room? We will take a holy communion, amen, together. Again, if you don't have your sacraments, please see one of the ushers. we will be partaking in this all together. Amen. Glory unto God. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. And he told his disciples while they were around the table, he said, take, eat of it, all of it, and do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper was over, as they gathered around the table, he took the cup and he said, this is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. He said, take and drink of it, all of it, and do this in remembrance of me. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you, God. We thank you on this Communion Sunday, oh God. We thank you for how you touched each and every one of us and reminded us of this sacred sacrament that you shared with your disciples. Lord, we ask that through the bread and through the wine, it strengthens us and reminds us of what you've done for each and every one of us, oh God. We thank you. Lord, we ask that you continue to fortify us, strengthen us, guide us and direct us and remind us that you are God who can look beyond our faults and meet us at our needs if we believe. So God, we thank you and ask you all of these blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Let us prepare to go down from this place, but never from the presence of our God. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly beyond all that we ask, think, or imagine, to God be the glory, to the church, and to all generations forever and ever. Let the people all over the world sing amen, amen, and amen. Go in peace, my brothers and my sisters, and may the peace of the Lord continue to rest, rule, and abide. Only in Jesus' name.